Greetings, fellow travelers, explorers, independent thinkers, and seekers alike, and welcome to the Nexus. On episode 18, we have returning guest Josh Kintigh of Ancient Amnesia. On this episode, we're going to explore a number of topics primarily focused around cosmetry and planetary dynamics. We'll talk about how the Earth is and maybe isn't, and the things that we have been told that might be and probably aren't. Things like fossil fuel, things like expanding Earth, things like what the hell are these guys talking about, as you can always expect on the Nexus, where interesting people talk about interesting things, having interesting conversations. Grab your favorite libation, sit back and enjoy the discussion, and hear what you may not have known before. Welcome to the Nexus. And welcome to today's Nexus NexCast, episode 18. Today, we have returning guest Joshua Kintigh to talk about cosmetry and cosmetry dynamics. The things that are going on outside the Earth and the beautiful blue pale dot that we inhabit, and the things that are going on within it, because they're all interrelated and they're all going off at the same time in varying degrees and extremes. So as Josh, as you know from our last show, is one of those independent researchers and content creators that explores all those really cool aspects of things like what we're talking about today. What's going on in the planet? What's going on in the solar system? What's going on in the galaxy? Are any of these things cyclical? Are any of them periodic? And do any of them individually or collectively have some kind of potential impact on what we experience as we rumble and mobile about in our carbon-based meat suits? Did I really just say that?
That was amazing, Robert. Thank you.
I tell you what, that was, go ahead, Josh, take it from there.
Yeah, well, thanks for having me on, man. I'm not sure I can beat that right there, but I'm going to take a swing. You know, I think when people try to understand the Earth and the place they're in, they forget that the Earth itself has its own place in a larger system that you could call the, you know, solar system's weather, that in turn is in a galactic, you know, type of weather. And all of those different systems are going to have different dynamics that we don't even really know anything about yet. And so we're really, really young in our understanding of the scales that go out and how they scale down to our level. I mean, we have a hard time even today understanding our own Earth weather and its own cycles, and there's a lot of debate, you know, going on about that. But even further, you know, you are obviously a child of the sun, and so solar cycles are going to be huge, and that's probably the next phase up. And I think that right now there's a lot of actually information coming out about solar minimums and that we're going through one and all of these solar cycles and how they're affecting the Earth's climate. But we have to remember that we're a part of a bigger picture, and that we have very little understanding today of exactly how that bigger picture affects us, at least on this scale. So we have a lot of learning to do.
Well, one of the things that you mentioned there is for a scale, a term that I find extremely interesting in and of itself, and especially even more interesting when you apply it to you know, this thing that I call the informatica, the metrics matter component of information. Information is what delineates and differentiates that which you are observing, considering, thinking, being, doing, whatever it might be. And that term that I have found extremely useful is scale variance.
Yeah.
And when you think about what that means, it's everything has a scale of some kind. Again, it's a metric of determining some sense of volume, size, whatever it might be, density. It is a scale that is a set of metrics that defines and gives distinction to that which that space is. Now, variance is how much variance, how much it goes from one direction to another. Mm-hmm. Does it expand? Does it contract? As we were talking earlier, and by the way, that show, we're going to have some fun with that show, which wasn't a show, but it turned into a show because it was a dynamic discourse of amazing stuff. And there was quite the interesting intellectual exchange going on in that. But I digress. Get back to variance. When you look at things that have variability, they get large, they get small, they go dim, they go bright. It doesn't matter. There's some variable of their characteristic that you can observe. And that you look at these things and you go, there is something called weather. And weather has scale. It has its quiet periods and it has its very active periods. It has energetic. It has content rich in the form of H2O and its various aspects and the way that it manifests itself from solid gas to liquid. How cool is that? All of those are variances. So when you look at some things individually like that, like we're talking about on planetary and cosmetry dynamics that are going on, you can look at one thing and go, wow, that's pretty intense. You look at a tornado or a hurricane and you look at the really intense manifestations of weather expressed energy on Earth, and it's some powerful stuff.
Very much so. Yeah, I mean, it's scary to think about what's happened here. And this is, you know, ties into the work that I do on my spot, which is trying to uncover how these patterns and these cycles have affected the evolution of our civilizations and potentially covered up multiple ones going back into unknown history. And we don't know, you know, what's happened via weather or cosmic weather or galactic weather in the ancient past and how much that's actually affected us as a species. So it is something that's really necessary for us to kind of look at and understand on a larger level and start looking a little bit more into what's outside of the planet. You know, I've always found it fascinating that, you know, if you take about the solar system, 99% of the solar system's mass is obviously the sun. I mean, the sun is enough to just study to realize that the cycles it goes through are going to affect every single thing that it's pulling as it, you know, travels around the galactic arm. And I do believe that that it's probably going to be the major player, at least in terms of what Earth is doing, without any type of cometary impacts being involved or any other type of comet or anything coming in. But anything else, I would say it probably plays the major role of what's actually happening in terms of these polar ages coming, these ice ages, or even potentially pole shifting, magnetic shifting and traveling that we're experiencing today. So I think the sun's a really good start for us to start to scale out as we move from our pattern into more of the galactic type weather that we're trying to understand.
Yeah, and I think that that's the other aspect of scale variance that becomes even more interesting. You can start with, you know, one particular dynamic, one set of metrics, the sun, the weather, pick one. But then when you start adding others that are at play at the same time, when they are afoot, together, there's a confluence of these things. We've got this, you know, from my perspective, I look at things and I try to find the opposite answer to see if there is how well the original answer holds up. Okay. So consideration of the opposite of what may be proffered as, you know, the establishment, the accepted truth. It's a real fun game to go on and say, well, so what's the other side of this? What is another aspect of this that could be completely antithetical or at least be different off by some degree to where it's not quite the same, but it has a different answer. And I find that to be extremely valuable in trying to determine if the metrics that I'm using to understand that which I'm considering hold up. Do they need to be modified? Do they need to be added to? Do they need to be replaced?
Yeah. Well, what makes it difficult to try to feel confident to attach yourself to a certain idea or theory or a convolution of theories, it's that you have to trust the systems and the metrics and the methodologies that it takes to measure these things accurately. And what happens when you scratch the surface of science is you tend to find out that a lot of the things they claim is actually very solid theory is really not backed up with as much evidence as maybe you would require for you to feel attached to that particular theory. And this happens across multiple different categories in science. So when you actually look at the big picture that science is trying to sell us, and this ties into even earth mechanics, like what is at the center of the earth? We don't really know these things. They can tell us, and you're going to read in science books and secondary scientific literature, which is what they teach in universities and schools. That's what you're going to learn. And you're going to feel like that's true because you learned it in college, you got a master's degree. But the actual reality of it being 100%, positively true is really not the situation. And so we do have to understand that as we project our ideas forward and try to at least attach a little comfort zone with them, because we're still guessing. And again, we've talked multiple times about then other fields and potential dimensional things and things that we haven't even become aware of that play into all this. So it's, it just can get really out there. So you do have to at least say, well, at least from what we're being told and the information that seems to be out there, what does this say and what does this mean? And we have to just kind of take it from there.
Yeah, and there's always new data that's showing up. There's new ways as thinking and observing how the metrics are created and how they're applied and what they reveal as they are applied, because again, going to the scale variance, think about carbon 14. I mean, how long has it been that there's been a dependency on what that model and consistency was? And then more data comes in, we find out it's not quite as accurate and it's got a shelf life and. And that's just because more data shows up. So speaking of what we're talking about here in the planetary side of the dynamics, there's a very interesting component to the whole climate science debate that goes into the cyclical nature of the way in which the planetary dynamics, the way that the geology, the morphic resonance in Sheldrake's term, of the way that the habits of the Earth, the geology of the that makes up the materium, how it functions. And what it does, and as you just pointed out, the oceans cover 70-80%, 75% of the surface area of the globe that has edges because it's flat. Within that entire space of the oceans themselves and the ocean floors, particularly around the coasts of various continents, there is a wealth of information and data on civilizations and all kinds of things. Antarctica, the underneath the ice sheet, where there is so much information that is yet to be uncovered.
Mm, yeah.
We are living in these, primarily in these focused areas along the coasts of the major continents where there's a big concentration of people because people like to live next to water. And that's why there's so many ruins and ancient things that are along the coast, because there was a lot less water on the surface 12, 15,000 years ago, right? You're 300 feet roughly lower than it is today. You've got Bimini, you've got Dwarka, you've got Yanaguni. There is so many different obvious pre-existing establishments of carbon-based units that took rocks and stones, built something, and made a place where they hung out.
Mm. Yeah. Now, I mean, if we...
right?
Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, if we take the model that the Earth is 4 billion years old, I mean, how long does it take for life to form into complexity and get completely destroyed back to its, cellular or a single cellular level? I mean, there's plenty of evidence that there's the potential of that happening as comets, asteroids are flying around different areas in space. I mean, it could be a solar event, you know, it could be a solar flare that comes and destroys everything. It could be anything, but it's going to be
a combination.
Sure. It could be a combination of both, but and you got 4 billion years to play with. This is just going by, you know, what we're told. So if you, you know, you take that into account, you know, and the idea that there's plate tectonics and shifting, and there's going to be a lot of, opportunities for advanced, earth evolved creatures, to have risen and fallen, and there'd be civilizations, powdered over and over time. So, you know, that's something I think we need to come to terms with, because it's silly to think anything else, at least in my opinion.
Well, and this goes back to what we were talking about as far as, or what I was mentioning in scale variance and cycles, and as it relates to climate. And in this climate debate, it's not even really a debate. It's like a bunch of people standing around on either side of the street, just throwing shit at each other. There really isn't a debate. It is in the traditional sense of a debate. It doesn't even have to be a debate, just a discourse. Let's just start with talking. We can debate data and facts all day long, but when you come out with a position that says this is the way it is, and if you don't agree, then you are obviously not cool. And that's just a non-starter in any kind of free-thinking model, or for anybody who has a reasoned or rational intellect and likes to really explore things. So, to that point, I've got a video. We've got about 7 minutes left in this first segment. I've got a video that I'm going to play. It's about 4 minutes. And I want you to pay attention to the information that is presented and the way in which it's presented. And then let's talk about what we think this guy has put together and how relevant it might be to this discourse. All right, stand by. Do you see that now?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's give it a play and see what happens.
With the Paris Climate Agreement put to bed, climate mania seems to have died down for the time being. So I think it's time for a little dose of reality, because it's getting colder and drier, and it's all because of the sun and the planets. You see, everything that happens on Earth happens in cycles. The only straight line is in man's mind. There are no straight lines in nature. Everything in nature is formed by spinning spheres or waves. So when you tell me that the temperature is going to go straight up, I become more than a little skeptical, because nothing ever goes straight up, and certainly not forever. Let's look at climate cycles over the past 11,000 years. The big picture. You can see on this diagram that we came out of the glacial period about 10,000 years ago. And then we had these up and down periods of warm and cold, cycles. It's like a giant sine wave. Temperature moves up and down over time on a highly predictable schedule. Today, we're in what's called the modern warm period. And there's climate mania, even though it's been warmer on Earth many times before. In fact, the trend line shows it's gradually getting cooler because the sun is cooling. Nobody disputes that. Well, no astrophysicists, at any rate. The next cold period is signified by the dark blue blob right below climate mania. It's starting now. But how do we know all this? Well, in the early 1900s, Dr. Raymond Wheeler, with a team of about 200 researchers, analyzed climate back about 20 centuries to 600 BC. He used tree rings and sunspot records to plot both temperature and rainfall over that entire period. He identified major climate cycles of 100, 170, 515, and 1,030 years. Now, he predicted extreme weather at about the year 2000, followed by a turn colder and a long-term drought. And sure enough, that's exactly what seems to be happening. In fact, the global temperature has gone sideways since 1998. Oh, yes, it has. And the recent drop in solar activity is warning of a much colder time coming ahead. What's more, the head of the International Space Station, a Russian astrophysicist with a name I can't pronounce, has publicly predicted a mini ice age is on the way. Now, let's drill down to the most recent 4,000 years. This chart uses data from the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration. It comes from the Greenland Ice Core Research Project, ending in 1992. Ice cores are an extremely accurate method of determining temperature back through the centuries. What's interesting about this chart is that it accurately supports all of Dr. Wheeler's cycles. You can see the large temperature peaks every 1,030 years, the red arrows. These extremely warm and wet periods supported bountiful crops so that major societies grew to the height of their power. Dr. Wheeler called it the civilization cycle. You can see the 172-year peaks as well, the orange arrows. In almost every case, the temperature turned colder at the 172-year mark. Now, 2007 was the most recent major turn date. But the other remarkable thing about this chart is the correlation with major civilizations. When the climate turns warm and wet for long periods, the world's greatest empires have emerged. Egypt, Greece, Rome, the Mayans, the Vikings, and so on. When the climate grew colder, these great cultures fell into ruin. Bad things start to happen when climate turns cold. Rome burned as it got colder. Hadrian's Wall was built to keep out invaders at the bottom of a cold spell. Social mood always turns negative with colder climate, and that brings about riots and wars. Cold periods often get labeled as dark ages because there is little advancement in living standards. So here we are at the top of the modern warm period. Unless this time is different, the Earth is going to get a lot colder and drier, most likely for several hundred years. We'll also see a major financial collapse. Yeah, that's one of the great features of the 172-year cycle. It's happened throughout history like clockwork. So, we've spent billions of dollars on this climate mania for nothing, really. We had this information more than a century ago. The sun and the planets are the main drivers of climate change on our tiny little planet. We know that. We can't change Mother Nature. It's going to get colder and drier. There's no question about that. You see, history repeats over and over and over again. So if you want to know the future, you look at the past. But of course, nobody does that. They'd much rather program computers to try to simulate what they think is man-made warming. Meanwhile, just when we're going to need more energy and warmth, we have politicians trying to tax it out of existence and shut down coal plants. If we paid attention to cycles and history, maybe we could plan for the tough times every 172 years.
So what did you think of that, my friend?
Yeah, that's pretty incredible. You know, I've looked a little into that stuff and you know, it's solid science. I mean, it's not something that is you can really deny. And that's, I think people don't even understand that data is out there. It's not hard to find and it's pretty easy, like he did, break it down. And these things are highly accurate. So, you know,
the thing is that it's data, it's independent data of different subject matters, right? So you have the civilizations, you have the warming and cooling periods, you have a time scale, and you're overlaying information. Climate information over civilizations over a period of time, and individually you could take the civilization chart and say, here's the major civilizations that we have tracked over the last 2,000 years. And by the way, we're at the end of this segment, so we are going to pick this up on the other side. But the whole idea of looking at different pieces of data, looking at their metrics, and then overlaying them individually into a collective view, that's some pretty powerful stuff.
Well, it is. I mean, because that's the problem with science today, is that you have isolated information, and the people that are doing the science, they're not studying to the same degree they are their methods, the other realms. We've talked about that. So
my whole issue is there's not enough interdisciplinary.
Right. There needs to be a body that it's focused on pulling the data, synthesizing it. And that's what's not happening. And
all right, well, let's pick up. We've got a whole bunch more to cover in the second segment. So thank you, everybody, for joining us in this first segment. We're going to take a quick little break, and we will see you on the other side. And welcome back to the Nexus NexCast, episode 18 with Josh Kintigh. And we're talking about planetary and cosmetry dynamics on this show. And if you listen to the first segment, you know that we ended with some information that was taking individual knowledge stacks and looking at the way that they're met, the metrics that define them, and then overlaying individual stacks of knowledge on top of each other and seeing where there is correlation. And Larry did a phenomenal job, I think, in putting together a view of the cyclical nature of the way in which climate and civilizations have manifested over the relatively recent 2,000 or so years of history that we can kind of sort of give enough defensibility and credibility to. There's some great work by Fomenko about, is that really 1,000 years versus 2,000? But that's a whole nother show. So in this segment, we're going to explore more of this, these metrics and the way that they are, what's going on in the cosmic world outside of our little pale blue dot and the dynamics that are going on here. And I want to start this by tossing out some ideas. One of the things that I mentioned in the previous segment was I like looking at whatever the initial presentation of data is, and then looking at all of the opposite information or the contrary or antithetical information related to that subject, because it gives you a bigger context. And I know in my personal experience, the more I have gathered nuggets of knowledge, put them on the table and noodled them in my noggin, I'm finding that there's a lot of things that seem to be, are not as solid and or should be accepted as truth or fact as they should be. So before I nail down a couple of these, in fact, let me go ahead and start with those as a matter of fact, because then we can go to the truth or fact question. Number one, I believe that there's more evidence supporting a plasma core to the planet and to the sun than there is a solid or semi-liquid or some state of iron. And I think that there's a lot of information that supports a plasma kind of model, and it supports things like another example of something that we're told is one way, and I think it's kind of something else, and that is an expanding Earth. The uniformitarian view is, and the current physics model says that the Earth has grown to the size that it is. We all have heard about the Pangaea, Gondwana land, and the expansion of the Earth that separated the continents into where we are now, into Hapgood's tectonic plate theories and so forth. However, if we have a plasma core instead of an iron core, that would explain an expanding Earth. That would also explain a number, give some reason and evidence to the magnetic field of the Earth and the way in which it moves and the way in which it pulses and the way in which it flips. I also think that along with the expanding Earth, it gives rise to a hollow Earth, that there are chambers and places within the mantle and the construct of the geophysical components of the Earth that are empty or void in some way, shape, or form. So if you have a plasma core that's causing an expanding Earth, you then have hollow sections that could materialize as a result of that. So those are three things from a planetary perspective that I feel much more comfortable with the explanations of what we see and what the evidentiary empirical data is than the standard model of iron core, the Earth is stable, and there is no, there's no underground people or places that could be in a hollow Earth model. So, Mr. Kintigh, I ask you, what is the truth and what are the facts? As to those three things,
I wouldn't know exactly what would be true or what would be fact. I mean, there could be a little bit of truth in both cases, right? There could be a 50% of each of them. Maybe there's a little truth to all of them.
What do you think about those three? Am I in Colorado smoking the good stuff or what?
Well, I mean, I personally believe that that it makes more sense for there to be, you know, an electric universe. I mean, there is research recently that just came out of them confirming that there is a plasma filaments that are connecting the stars, the suns, to
the galactic, magnetic rope.
Mm-hmm. Right. So we do know that there's going to be this, communication. I mean, it's in our bodies. We obviously know that, and this is kind of how our brain works. It follows channels and fires electricity through them. And so it just seems kind of a something that we see in nature. And it would make total sense that this would scale out. It would also explain a lot of things that are going on with the Earth's magnetic poles as they shift around. I mean, true north is the axis to the Earth, which we know has a precessional cycle. Magnetic north is a completely different thing, and that's changes over time. It tends to skittle around, but as of now, I believe it's moving at about 34 miles per year from.
Yeah, it's up to 40, and it's going across.
It's going Canada, from the Arctic to Canada, right?
Well, it's going towards Siberia, right?
Right, and so it's moving east, and so we know that it's changing, and this ties back into the weather and patterns and the things that we see, and we have to understand that this process is probably being affected to a large degree by the sun. And the sun right now is showing a solar cycle minimum. Cycles are generally about 11 years. We're in cycle solar cycle 24 right now, and we've noticed almost 200 days or plus 200 days of zero sunspots. And what happens is that the sun, you have to think of the sun as something that's more of an organic living kind of being. I'm not necessarily going to go, and say that it's conscious. We can save that conversation for later, but let's at least understand that even in conventional knowledge, they'll say that this thing has its own, patterns, its own breathing patterns. And as it ejects these mass ejections, you have, different kind of cooling periods that kind of the sun goes through as it bursts out all of this cosmic radiation.
What's your thoughts on, the magnetic field of the Earth protects the Earth from cosmic rays, from solar wind? You've got the models that show how when we're bombarded with it, our magnetic field offers protection, as well as the ionosphere, right, and the various levels and the way in which the atmosphere manifests. But if we are going through a pole shift, and we also have the geomagnetic field over the last 100 years has weakened by up to 15 or 20%, and it's accelerated in the last 2 or 3 decades, what kind of impact and potential issue does that present us?
Well, what happens when that happens, when you have a solar minimum, is that the magnetic, so the magnetic field of the Earth is basically there to protect us against radiation. And what happens is that when there is an active sun, the Earth obviously warms because the magnetic field is protecting the Earth more from this, and there's this kind of warming kind of a effect that happens. And this is why we have these weather pattern changes. When the sun goes to a solar minimum, what happens is that the magnetic sphere of the Earth weakens. But what that does allow is other cosmic information to then come into the Earth. And so that's the question. And is the solar cycle, the solar minimums, allowing the Earth to de-shield itself and then take in other types of energy that we have yet to understand that may play a huge role into the part of, the weather patterns and civilization patterns and some of the other correlative material that you were presenting in the video in the first segment. So that, that's the question in my mind, is that if you have this model of a plasma sun, you have this model of a plasma core in planets that are active. These suns are then connected to all the other suns in the galaxy that itself is driven by some kind of core itself. You seem to have what looks to be more like a machine. And the question is, what's the machine built for, and what's our role in that process? So it's an interesting thing to kind of tie into.
I think that there's probably more afoot. There's more complexity in what is going on and the way in which it individually and collectively impacts, what we are experiencing as, humans on this beautiful planet in this Holocene period. We're based on, you know, if you looked at some of the stuff that Larry did, and as well as Randall Carlson, there's a definitive, obvious sine wave. And I like the way he used that as a sine wave. It's not even all the time. The amplitude and the modulation varies, but it's always doing this, right? You're always getting a sine wave pattern. Now, I find it fascinating. In fact, there's another video we can pull up here, which goes to my fourth point. You know what? First of all, we have a plasma, not an iron core. The Earth is constantly expanding. And I think that's to the conversation you and I had before this show. That is part of the nature of the cosmos. There is a constant expansion. There's a creation and transmutation cycle within an expanding cycle that it continues to expand. So if that is a natural and a part of the habit of the cosmos, then it would naturally apply to the Earth. So if you have a plasma core, which is energy that is constantly in motion and adding to itself, and you have the plasma versus the electric universe model, which I think there's more correlation there than there is separation, but plasma core, expanding Earth, hollow Earth. Let's talk about this thing called fossil oil, right? Fossil fuel. So the narrative is that this is the result of millions of years and gazillions of pounds of flora and fauna, fauna in the form of dinosaurs, that lived and then died and decomposed and became these vast pools of gooey stuff that just happens to be extremely useful. Or at least we've turned it into something that's very useful. So the narrative has been, this is fossil fuel. There is only so much. We have to be very judicious, and it's going to cost a lot. That last barrel of oil is going to be very expensive. Because when it's gone, it's gone. Because there was only so much flora and fauna to make this stuff gazillions of years ago. However, I think it's quite opposite. I think that fuel, oil, petroleum, in the sense of what we use and just about everything that we consume and use to go places in it, et cetera, is actually a natural geologic process of the Earth. It's not from flora and fauna. It's not from decomposing, decayed stuff. It's a part of the geologic process. It's essentially, look at it as like the lymphatic fluid in the human body, right?
Right.
So the Earth produces this stuff. It's a natural, just like producing natural gas. So it's not fossil. And the carbon that is its inherent component, that is what is expelled as it's used, particularly in automobiles and combustion engines, carbon is a part of the entire construct of what we know as the materium and biology here. So we exhale it, trees inhale it. We have this natural cycle of dependency of the way in which these minerals and geologic processes create the stuff they do. If that's true, then the whole narrative of fossil fuel, CO2 into the an anthropogenic expulsion of CO2 into the atmosphere is a very bad thing, and it needs to be taxed to manage and mitigate the way that you breathe, the things that you eat, the things that, I mean, the complete control of the fundamental element in carbon that makes everything go and makes everything what it is in this materium. Oh, you want to control that. That's the evil thing, the thing that everything is made of. So I don't want to get into the political debate in this, but my point is just from a logical look at the data perspective. Here's a knowledge stack of information. They've never proven that there's any fossils in any petroleum. It's all based on carbon. Well, carbon is everywhere. It's what everything is that we eat, we do, we wear, we drive, etc. So how can that be if it's so pervasive and so useful? What better way to control its consumption than to say it's something that it's not?
Yeah, I think part of the problem is that as we advance and become so technocratic, our idea of us as being a alien type creature to the planet and not a living part of the process of the planet, as if that we are we don't belong here. We're set apart. All we're doing is destroying the planet. You know, the planet doesn't want us here. These are the kind of, I think, ideas that the modern world has shifted into, especially as we've gotten into so much scientific reductionism, and we have tended to lose our connection with the Earth as we get into all these concrete cities, and we physically lose our connection. So that's part of it. I think it's part of the psychology of where we're at. So we would never, it would be very strange for us to understand that humans began using fossil fuels. That they call fossil fuels at the time to which the carbon necessity, the levels of carbon were dropping so low that at a certain 1,000-year level, we would have actually lost all life on planet Earth had the carbon not been put back into the atmosphere. And we seem to have actually been a part of the plan all along to actually pull this stuff out and get it up in there. So I think it's fascinating, and I think that shows the beauty of maybe what we would call a planetary mind. I mean, it's a better story that gives us more purpose, that we do belong here. We are helping. We know we can easily clean fuel. I mean, we can make it not toxic. Carbon is not a toxic material. If you wanted to grow plants and you wanted to get a garden that would feed lots of people, you would put it in a massive greenhouse and you would pump tons of carbon into.
Well, you saw that NASA study that came out a couple of months ago that said, you know, there's more green around the planet now than there has been in 30 years.
Yes, there's been 40% greening of the planet. We know there's a lot of biodiversity that is actually coming back from some of this stuff. And we know that in history, there was the most biodiversity when we had carbon levels much higher and temperatures much higher than they are today.
Temperatures means more green, which means more CO2, which means more warmth, which means more people being able to thrive and civilizations arise. And so, you know, that's one of the things in this whole narrative that is quite fascinating to me. The main push on the AGW side is a warming planet is bad.
Right.
Not according to the data.
Well, I mean, you have to think.
The data says that every time there's warmth, there's flourish and thriving
more
of human civilizations.
Right. I mean, people just have to ask themselves: is there more life in the rainforest or in the Arctic? I mean, life is going to go where there's more CO2, where there's more oxygen flow, and there's more warmth, and that's where you see the most life on the planet Earth. So it makes a lot of sense if you just kind of look at what's going on. And I think that's the key thing, is that we're just kind of disconnected from the natural planetary cycles now. We're just locked into these.
Well, I think that one of the reasons we're disconnected is because the narrative has been hijacked.
Right.
Going back to what is truth versus fact. Okay. Right. Now, the truth in the way that it's being presented is that oil, petroleum is fossil based, that it produces CO2, which is bad, that will produce warming, which is bad, and we need to control and tax this thing and get it under control because we've magically found the thermostat to the temperature of the planet, regardless of the ice cores and the data and the cycles that we have clearly identified through scientific method that these things happen, and this is what's happening now. So the narrative is completely the opposite and being sold as the truth of what the facts show. And that was my whole point about getting into truth versus facts. The data, and that's why I also wanted to delineate those things that I think are the opposite of what we are told, and the definitions or explanations that I'm siding with now explain a hell of a lot more of what has been observed, and it gives credence to the facts that are opposite of the truth of the narrative of things like climate change and the constructs of the planet, which has everything to do with how we're going to survive and thrive going forward.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I want the warmth.
Yeah.
Who doesn't?
You know, you know, think about Russia and Canada and Alaska and all those, all that continent that can't grow as much food as the ones that are in the warmer regions. I mean, so much more produce would be grown if it got warmer in those regions. And but ice kills. I mean, we know that ice is much more dangerous. It is something that, you know, not much can actually live in. So you're going to have a harder time in any type of extreme cold as a civilization. And like the last presentation showed, that when things were warmer and there were solar changes, more sun activity, you had the rise of civilizations. And when the solar activity went down and things got cooler, you had things like the Dark Ages, the Middle Ages, and ages where crops wouldn't grow. We've done several podcasts talking about that. And that's something that that people need to understand, because again, it goes back to what we were originally saying, is it puts them in a bigger scale of reference, of perception that they can then tie into. And the stuff that they read is not going to affect them as much. They're going to understand a larger truth. And so all of these, you know, different things that are coming at them on a cultural level, they can kind of go, well, you know, that doesn't even make sense. And that's going to just kind of help them, you know, deflect some of this junk that's out there.
And to support the narrative that I just ranted on about as it relates to, is oil a geologic, natural, lymphatic type fluid of the earth, or is it fossil? And I think you'll find this quite fascinating. Let me see here. All right. Tell me if you can hear this, Josh.
You mentioned in one of your last talks,
yep,
that petroleum wasn't what we thought it was, that it wasn't a fossil fuel, that it didn't come from fossil animals.
Yeah.
Is it just a mineral? Is it a mineral like any other mineral?
When they first found petroleum, because they were beginning to make motors and needed on axles of wheels on railroad trains and all that sort of thing, and remember, trains started in the beginning of the 19th century, then oil went from just a lubricant to a fuel, and it made it valuable. And Rockefeller happened to be the smartest man in the business at the time, but he made most of his money, or much of it, off the transport of the petroleum as well as selling it. But one thing they realized was, putting a price on oil is like putting a price on a pail of water. You know, no initial cost. It's in the ground, and in those days they were, some of it, almost what you'd call surface mining the oil. They didn't go down deep. So in order to get the price up, they hit on the idea that they would have to make it appear to be scarce. After we take the next few barrels out, we're probably going to have to close as well, you know, that kind of thing. But a very fortuitous event. In 1892, there was a convention in Geneva of scientists to determine what organic substances are. Well, the definition of organic is a substance with hydrogen, oxygen, and carbon. And so it's usually a living substance, a tree. You analyze a dead tree, hydrogen, carbon, and oxygen, and grass, and so on, living things, animals. We are hydrogen, oxygen, and carbon. So at this Geneva Convention, Rockefeller took advantage of sending some scientists over who said, oil, petroleum, is hydrogen, oxygen, and carbon. Therefore, it must be derived from the spoiling, the rotting of formerly living matter. And playing the game properly, when this scientific convention was over, they defined oil as a residue from formerly living matter. Well, that makes it a fossil fuel. I don't know why they decided to use the word fossil, but it says formerly living matter, it's fossil. Well, of course, today, and another thing we should know is that there has never been a fossil, a real fossil, found below 16,000 feet. And you can't argue at 16,000 is a level line, because someplace the ground sinks and so on. But 16 is what the scientists say, 16,000. We mine oil, or we drill for oil, at 30,000, 33,000, 28,000 every day of the week. So right there, we rule it out that it isn't fossil fuel. It's called fossil fuel for the minds of the public to feel that it is an asset that is running out, being depleted. We talk about depletion allowance, which is a lot of, you know. And actually, if you know the world's oil supply, you know that it is not going to run out for an awfully long time. It is the second most prevalent liquid on Earth.
And that's my point, is that the scientists will tell you, you know, why, you know, we know this is something that is more of like you say, a lymphatic fluid of the Earth, or some kind of, you know, living process that continues to restore and refill. And it's, like I said, he said, the second most
liquid on the planet, right?
Right. And so, you know, so again, that's just showing you that the secondary literature then gets changed, or never gets, you know, revised. So this is how it works. And this is, what does this say about everything that we think about, or what we're told about resources and animals and biodiversity and climate and space and in the cosmos and all these other things. So, yeah, all bets are off, Robert.
Well, that's the thing to me. And again, the reason that I know that I'm doing my show, you do your shows, and we do the research that we do, is because when you look at the narrative that's been offered as the officialdom, this is what we have: climate change. Okay, yeah, everybody agrees there's climate change. It's being caused by too much consumption and use of fossil fuels by humans. Really? There's a whole bunch of data over here that's antithetical to that. But you must believe this because the scientists say this is what's going on. There's the, you know, 97% or whatever, which is completely debunked. All you have to do is look at it. That is not, it would ended up being 33% of a sample of less than 1,000, not every, you know, scientist.
Well, and,
you know, you look at it and you go, well, but wait a minute. You're selling me something that, as you've taken facts, you've repackaged them, you've put new metrics around it, you've created a narrative around it, and you've said, this is what is truth.
Yeah. Well, there's a common denominator behind all of it, right? It's be afraid. They're
what
never
is it
telling
with
you,
this fear point?
Have you ever noticed that every single thing that they try to tell you about anything has this kind of factor of fear into it, which is like, you know, things could go bad really quickly. You should be afraid, and there's problems, and that puts people in a certain state of mind. And when they're in that certain state of mind, they're a little easier to manipulate, and they, you know, they don't relax and get creative and start becoming a little more, I would say, independent and a little bit more self-reliant and things like that.
Josh, as usual, we've covered the landscape. We've looked at all of the nuggets that we brought to the table on this one. What can I say? It's always an exploratory travel of what the hell was that all about? And when you sit back and you listen to it and you look at it, you go, there's some pretty damn good information in there. I'm going to have to figure out how to take those nuggets, put them together, and make some sense out of it. So in the meantime, since we're at the end of the second segment on this episode of the Nexus NexCast, Josh, tell everybody how they can find Ancient Amnesia, you, and the work you're doing.
I appreciate you having me on, Robert. It's always a blast. You know, we can talk for hours, and I hope to do that in the future. So I thank everybody for listening. I hope you enjoyed the show. If you want to find my work, you can go to ancientamnesia.com. That's our home. Constantly updating. There's over 700 articles and tons of videos and hours of fun. You can go there and find pretty much all of our work. Our Facebook page is Ancient Amnesia, and please join that. If you want to join the discussion, you can go over to Ancient Amnesia Discussion Group and generate some conversation with some like-minded people. We really want you to be a big part of it. And then please, obviously, all of our podcasts are archived on YouTube at our Ancient Amnesia Podcast YouTube spot. So go there, subscribe. You know, comment and let us know what you're thinking. But we are pumping out a lot of material, and we hope people enjoy it and they're getting to it. And, you know, I just appreciate you, Robert, for having me on so that people could get a little taste.
Well, it's always a blast, Josh, and we there's so much to talk about. Like we've mentioned before, we've got a whole bunch in the archive. Hell, we've got a couple hours before we even did this show that we can put together that was quite fascinating in the consciousness realm. So thank you for being here and just doing what you do, because this is where the fun is. This is where the nuggets in the noggins get knocked together and we go, what did that mean? How does that fit? What's potentially behind that curtain? So we like to pull the curtain back. Thanks again, everybody, for joining us today on the Nexus NexCast. Remember, we are one in many and many in one, so keep your eyes open and look behind you, too, because you never know who's coming. Take care. We'll see you next time. I hope you enjoyed the conversation, found it stimulating, and potentially longing for more, which we will be doing for sure. The Nexus NexCast can be heard on Odyssey One Radio Network at odysseyone.com, YouTube channel, The Nexus NexCast, under Professor Bauer, where you can see the show as well, and join in the live chat every Tuesday and Friday at 11 p.m. Eastern. You can find The Nexus YouTube, Odyssey One, and Streaming Talk Radio. Thanks again for joining us. Until next time.